May I commence the proceedings, Lord? Tamil Taiwan. I request the Advocate General to give farewell address to the Honorable Chief Justice of Madras High Court.
Honorable Chief Justice of the Madras High Court, Justice A.P. Sahi, Honorable Judges of the Madras High Court, former Judges of the Madras High Court, family members of Chief Justice Sahi, Learned Additional Solicitor General Thiru Shankaranarayanan, and we are specially honored for his presence here because this is his first function after being appointed as an Additional Solicitor General. Learned Additional Advocate Generals Thiru V.S. Sethuraman, Thiru P.H. Arvind Pandian, Thiru Chella Pandian, Thiru S.T.S. Murthy, Thirumati Narmada Sampat, Thiru S.R. Rajagopal, Thiru A. Kumar, Thiru Emilias, Thiru Sri Charan Rangarajan and Thiru Kumaresan, Learned Public Prosecutor Thiru A. Natarajan, Learned Government Leader Thiru Jayaprakash Narayan, the Learned Government Leader of Puducherry Thirumati Mala, the Learned Public Prosecutor of Puducherry Mr. Bharathan Chakravarti, and law officers attached to the central and state governments, Chairman of the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry Thiru P.S. Amalraj and Vice Chairman Thiru Karthikeyan, Co-Chairman of the Bar Council of India Thiru S. Prabhakaran, the President of the Madras Bar Association Thiru A.R.L. Sundaresan, the President of the Madras High Court Advocates Association Thiru Mohanakrishnan, the President of the Women Lawyers Association Thirumati Luisal Ramesh, the President of the Law Association Thiru L. Chengotivan, office bearers of the respective associations, the Registrar General, officers and staff of the High Court, respected seniors and beloved junior advocates, representatives of the electronic and print media, and ladies and gentlemen. Today, it is my sad duty to bid farewell to Chief Justice Amareshwar Pratap Sahi on his retirement as a judge of the Madras High Court, after having served for over 16 years and 3 months as a judge of the Allahabad High Court and as Chief Justice of the Patna High Court and the Madras High Court. Chief Justice Sahi came to Madras on 11-11-2019 and had a tenure in this court for a little over a year and 50 days. During that period, he has disposed of 1,555 main cases and 2,342 miscellaneous cases at Madras, including one before a full bench, and 322 main cases and 329 miscellaneous cases at Madurai bench, making a grand total of 1,877 main cases and 2,671 miscellaneous cases. This figure would have been much higher but for the fact that he was forced to take 2 breaks from the discharge of his judicial duties, one because of the intense lockdown that took place from the end of March till the beginning of July 2020, and the other from October to December of 2020 because of a brief illness. Nevertheless, the statistics are very impressive. But statistics often paint only a part of the picture. Sometimes they don't tell the real story. Statistics will not tell you about the quality of the judgments and the craftsmanship, diligence, and deep study that went into the formulation of the points and the drafting of each of the 1,877 judgments that were delivered. Some of them running to over 100 pages, and the judgment rendered today on the last day of his tenure running to over 400 pages. Statistics will not speak about the level of engagement that he had with each of the lawyers who argued before him, nor will they indicate the deep discussions and the debates that went on in court, or the feeling of satisfaction that it gave to every lawyer who argued in his court, the feeling that they had had the opportunity to argue before a great judge. In every case, he would discover some point which would elevate the level of discussion to a higher legal plane. One could see that this judge lived and breathed the law, and his love for the law resulted in a deep erudition that became immediately apparent in every case that he conducted. For Chief Justice Sahi, every case was a voyage, an adventure of learning, and one could almost see the excitement and gleam in his eye when he discovered a new point or the applicability of a legal proposition to the facts of a case before him. All this came from a deep love of reading and of books. Very often, when I used to meet him in his chambers on an official matter, he would have a book in his hand and he would proudly tell me that he had just acquired this book for the judge's library and that I should also read it. Heading a large high court like the Madras High Court with a robust subordinate judiciary in terms of the number of courts and judges can challenge any person's administrative skills. And here also, Chief Justice Sahi excelled. Part of being a leader is having the ability to spot talent in others and to delegate work in a manner which would enhance productivity. The administrative committees set up by Justice Sahi responded to his leadership skills and delivered on all the tasks that were assigned to them. Every file that was brought to his table was cleared as quickly as possible. Decisions were taken by Chief Justice Sahi with utmost expedition, but not in haste. A lot of thought went into each of his administrative decisions. Certain issues which had been kept on hold for a couple of years, such as the designation of senior advocates, were also taken up for consideration. He ensured that the decision-making process did not get entangled in red tape, and he quickly found solutions to long-standing issues. He even managed to discharge the constitutional obligations of the collegium. During his tenure, we have witnessed the creation of infrastructural creation of 75 new courts and 7 quarters for staff. We have also seen the creation of 62 new courts, 30 in the cadre of district judge, 15 in the cadre of sub-judge, and 17 in the cadre of civil judge. Even in the High Court, 13 new posts were sanctioned during his time. These all go to show the administrative skill sets that he had. However, it was his handling of the situation arising out of the coronavirus pandemic which deserves a special mention. Approximately 4 months after the start of his tenure, the entire country went on an intense lockdown and the justice delivery system was put to a severe challenge. In the early days of the lockdown, everybody felt that it would be a highly temporary phase and that things would get back to normal within 3 weeks. Nobody could predict that physical hearing of courts would not resume for a long period of time, and at the end of every month, we were all under the impression that next month would bring normalcy. Chief Justice Sahi took a proactive rather than a reactive role and decided to take very strong measures to create a robust infrastructure for virtual hearings to take place. I am proud to state that under his leadership, the Madras High Court has been the best performing High Court in the country in these troubled times. I do not have the official statistics, but as a keen observer, I think the disposal rate of the High Court has actually increased in the last few months as compared to the last year. Chief Justice Sahi is also an excellent public speaker. Many lawyers have the gift of advocacy, but if you put them in front of a microphone and an audience, they tend to fumble badly. Chief Justice Sahi had a clarity of thought which translated into the right words to every public gathering that he addressed. I know that it is a tradition for the Advocate General to refer to a few landmark judgments that a retiring judge has delivered during his tenure. But in this case, I feel I would be doing an injustice to Chief Justice Sahi, since every judgment was a masterpiece by itself. I would, however, like to refer to one passage from a recent judgment regarding the usage of words. In paragraph 14 of the judgment relating to a suo moto criminal contempt against the actor Surya, he says, "The etymology of a word displays the meaning which it seeks to convey. But its usage in a particular form with a particular intent is capable of giving it different meanings. And many of the words in all languages do convey meanings which are at times completely divergent. Nonetheless, an individual, while using a particular word or a sentence, may be intending to convey something that may be capable of being received by another and understood in a different form. The intention behind the oration, depiction, or diction can be fundamentally stated to be other than what has been said, but for that it has to be gauged on logic, reason, and commonality of its acceptance in general. Expression, therefore, has its own vitality and its own dynamics, which plays between two ends of being expressed and being understood." I myself have had the opportunity to appear before Chief Justice Sahi on many occasions, and I must be candid and confess that I thoroughly enjoyed every moment of my time before his court. He was extremely courteous to all lawyers and gave equal respect to both juniors and seniors. If a lawyer, whether he was a most junior lawyer or the senior most senior, if he was prepared in his brief, Chief Justice Sahi would give a very patient hearing. He had a deep understanding of the fundamentals of constitutional law, as well as most other branches of law, whether it was revenue law, labor and service, civil law, and even criminal law, a knowledge acquired from years of practice as an advocate and as a senior advocate, as well as from over 16 years of judicial service. In the final analysis, here was an extraordinary judge and administrator, and his retirement today is a great loss not only to the Madras High Court, but to the entire judiciary. Chief Justice Sahi had the good fortune to be born on the first day of the year, thereby ensuring that he had a holiday on every birthday. On behalf of the Bar of the Madras High Court and on my own behalf, I extend my advance birthday greetings to him and bid farewell to Chief Justice Sahi and wish him all the very best in his future endeavors. This bar will have very fond memories of you, sir, and I would like to make a request to you that if you ever happen to visit Chennai in future, please give us advance notice so that the bar can renew its acquaintanceship with you and have the privilege of spending some time with you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request the Honorable Chief Justice to give reply.
My esteemed colleagues on the bench, the learned Advocate General, all the office bearers of the respective bar associations, members of the registry, the entire staff of the High Court, and all my family members who have assembled here. I would especially thank Mr. Sankar Narayanan, who has written a beautiful poetic note to honor me with encomiums which I may not have deserved. But still, I think I have completed this part of the journey with full satisfaction and with no regrets. There is a feeling of fulfillment in me that I have served to the best of my capacity and ability and the oath that I had taken. But that was not possible unless I had the company of such an august brethren at Allahabad, at Patna, and now at the end of my career at Madras. Madras is a great place, and with its High Court as an institution, which is a magnificent embodiment of justice. I am thankful to Sister P.T. Asha, who today in the morning enriched my knowledge about the vibrations that are present in this entire area, because it is believed that the entire structure of the High Court is constructed in an area where there used to exist temples. And therefore, the said continuity of a temple with its priests is a real honor for any judge to sit in this High Court, and particularly a Chief Justice, as I said yesterday, would be a pilgrimage. I would begin by saying that I began my career not with any certainty. After completing my graduation, I had no other options left except to join law. And then I joined law and started wondering as to how I would wade myself through. Fortunately, my revered senior, late Mr. R.N. Singh, was one of those leading lawyers who was overburdened with cases. With when I joined chambers, it was almost 1,000 files current running and with 10,000 files already disposed of. So I was served in this profession with a platter, and I would say it was almost being born in the profession with a silver spoon, because I did not have the occasion to struggle as a lawyer, which is one of the major components of a practice which a lawyer definitely needs. Nonetheless, under his guidance, I went around for 19 years, and by the time I was elevated, it was just hard labor and passion, with 5 writ petitions at least and a couple of second appeals being drafted every day. This background which I got was the first step in augmenting whatever we call in our legal profession the legal acumen. The tricks of the trade, as you say, and the wit and humor of court craft, understanding of judges, and apprehending the worst of confrontation, either from the bench or from the bar, was all a great experience in the Allahabad High Court. I was fortunate also to have the opportunity to argue before judges who had been transferred from the Calcutta High Court in the days of the policy then. And they were some of the best judges. And I must confess today, when I am departing, that it was their recognition of my whatever little talent I had that I reached the bench. My colleagues who are still there, they were a great source of inspiration and help. And without their accompaniment, their challenges, their competitive attitude, I would not have been able to excel myself. I take this opportunity today to thank all of them who were responsible for molding me and allowing me to pave a way that ultimately led me to occupy the bench. I narrated this because I'm reminded of one of the American judges who said that the greatest challenge in life is what people say you cannot do. Most of the things worth doing in life were declared impossible before they were done. This is exactly what I feel today, that there were declarations that one would succeed or may not succeed or land up at an uncertain place in life. But in spite of those declarations and the rumors of impossibilities, I am here what I am, and I wish every lawyer, big or small, is able to complete this journey in this way. I was really overwhelmed with the outstanding favor given by the Madurai Bar and by the Madras Bar yesterday. One of my colleagues, Justice P.N. Prakash, even published his farewell in advance in the CTC, and it is worth reading, which is a piece of poetry. And I just now mentioned the letter of Mr. Sankar Narayanan. I think these are blessings, and these are my real earnings. All my colleagues, in one way or the other, wished me good, and many of them showered me with some of the choicest books that they felt would be read by me. I can't forget Brother Parthiban and Brother Sheshai, as well as Brother G.R. Swaminathan, who with their outstanding erudition have made me learn the language of the law, and the tricks of the trade have been taught to me by Brother Venkatesh Anand. There are many of my colleagues who have taught me something, and I have learned from them. The patient and very serious composition of Brother Kothari and Brother Satyanarayana, the extreme humble personality of Brother Subbaiya, the cheerful personality of Brother Sundaresh, the learned company of Brother Sivagyanam, and I would continue to say about everybody, but I will be failing in my duty, that my sisters on the bench, if they have not outclassed my male colleagues, they have certainly established a benchmark by telling the entire world that female judges, if elevated, will match no less than their male counterparts. A little word about lawyers. With the competition and with the growth of law, there is a lot of rush in courts. But there is always a search by the litigant for the best of the lawyer. All lawyers today, big and small, have the greatest opportunity to serve the public at large. But I must tell you that there is an equal rising disbelief and an inherent hesitation when one goes to engage a lawyer. The other side of the coin is that lawyers and doctors, they are embodiments of faith. When a client entrusts a brief, he does it with a sense that he will achieve justice. That is the end product that he wishes to receive. It is in this context that a lawyer's duty is most responsible. And in order to dispel any such disbelief, I think a disciplined conduct is essential. You see, we all live with prejudices, and every human being has a prejudice. Broadly, as I have understood, there are two types of prejudices: prejudice of interest and prejudice of ignorance. You have to avoid both these two. And therefore, when it comes to lawyers, they have to shed their prejudices, because they also have to perform not a biased but an impartial duty to achieve what is known as justice. Yet they have to serve the interest of the litigant and the client. This opportunity can be availed of with a discipline which I recently learnt, and I am trying to compare as an illustration. When I went to Sriharikota on a short visit to meet the anxiety of my little grandson who sits here, more interested in spacecraft. When I took rounds of the launching pads and I met the scientists, The first thing that I witnessed was their humility. They were far more academically superior than what I was. Yet the humility that they displayed is the first trait that a lawyer should try to inculcate. The second what I found was their simplicity. Hair going haywire with slippers on and with no formal dress. They just look like very simple people. With no airs, with no egos. And what I found was they took us around with such passion as if they have received somebody as a special guest. At that point I wondered, and all my brothers will think over it, particularly who meet such things in their judgments. Please ponder, and I will also request the learned SGI and the Advocate General to think over it and then discuss it amongst themselves. Why has the subject of law not been assigned the Nobel Prize? We come up with so much original thoughts, with so much of dealings with life itself. But why is it that social sciences, economics, literature, they all get their share of Nobel Prize? Why not law? Please think over it. And if you are able to make some suggestion on this, I would be glad to join you on this issue. And that is what the thought came to me when I was witnessing all this at Sriharikota. I believe, and that is subject to correction by anyone, it is the passion of scientists, their absolute devotion to their subject, and the sense of achievement that can be perceived thereafter, that appears to be the reason for Nobel Prizes being reserved from them. Is the legal profession and the entire legal fraternity today embalmed with such devotion, passion, or erudition so as to entitle them to claim a place amongst the Nobel Prize winners? The third thing that I learnt from Sriharikota was that the scientists were explaining the entire launch pad and the system over there through health related terms. They would say that this pillar or this particular structure is the umbilical cord of the rocket, and it is after all the health conditions as prescribed are suited for perfection, then only the button is pressed for the launch of the vehicle. Not only this, they also used that we perform a complete surgery which is amputating the project in the event the trajectory of the rocket fails, and which has to be done in 45 seconds. I asked them, you have used such terms, how do you manage to plan and execute such wonders of science? Then they started explaining it in human terms. They said, look here, these pillars are round in shape because we don't believe in edges. Edges obstruct, and which they said were nothing else but egos and prejudices. Then I asked them, why are you making these comparisons? Then they said, and with great pride, and with such a sense of pride that is really commendable, they said, all our scientists, senior scientists, directors, chairmen who have retired, they still come to us and we invite them whenever we are about to undertake a very major project. And they come here with the same passion, without any egos, without any prejudices, just to see that we do not fail. Now this is the attitude of the peers at Sriharikota. I take this opportunity to draw this illustration in our legal fraternity, just to remind all our junior lawyers that all activity, whatever be it, whether it is your drafting, whether it is your delivery, whether it is your art of persuasion, should not be without insight. You have to measure yourself first and then take a step forward. You have to get blessed first. And as I said yesterday in my address to the Madras Bar Association, reminding the Court of Justice Holmes, that the young ones know the rules, but it is the old ones who know the exceptions. Well, this might be amusing to some of us, but this is the truth of life. I hope that my journey in Madras has been comfortable to one and all. And now I have to begin with my thanksgiving before I conclude. Beginning with the Almighty who brought me in this world, with all my ancestors, all my family members, including my better half and my grandchildren, all my in-laws, and particularly my mother-in-law who is present here, my sister and my sister-in-law who are present here. They have been a great and a valuable support at every moment of my life. Not only they, but all those who were involved with me, the clerks who worked with me as a lawyer, the drivers, the domestics, each one of them were responsible for my rising to this position, because had I involved myself with their duties, maybe I would not have reached here. I thank all my colleagues at the bar at Allahabad, Patna. I thank all my colleagues on the bench at Allahabad and at Patna. I in particular thank Dr. Justice B.S. Chauhan, who has been my mentor at Allahabad. I will never forget the blessings of Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud as my Chief Justice, who was very much responsible for everything that I have achieved after he became my Chief Justice. I would be failing in my duty to thank Honorable Mr. Justice A.N. Verma of the Allahabad High Court, who was the first one to moot my name for elevation before Honorable Justice Tarun Chatterjee, who was kind enough to recommend me for elevation. There are a host of others who have contributed to this. both at the bar and on the bench. I would then thank those unsung heroes who are responsible for many things that they did. They are my chartered accountant, Mr. Rishi Kohli, the publishers of many journals who provided me with the best of assistance, the booksellers who were kind enough to inform me of every possible good book that would add to my personality. And there is a lot to thank the entire community that came together to bid me best wishes when I was elevated to the bench. I come to the members of the bar at Madras. They, with their, again, it is not an eulogy, it is a sense of satisfaction, a genuine and a sincere appreciation. They are the epitome of excellence of whatever I have seen of the bar in all the three high courts where I have been. Here, why I say so is that lawyers here have the unique ability of offering multiple alternatives when they argue their straightforward points. But nonetheless, the bench here, and with all the judges that we have on the bench, they have the capacity to mold every such argument into a pragmatic and a learned judgment. Lawyers, it is said that the bar is the mother of the bench. This is really true in that sense, which I have witnessed at Madras. Young and old, all can match each other. And they can satisfy and persuade any bench. And I could see, rather I have heard also, that lawyers directly connecting themselves to the Supreme Court and showing their par excellence, matching their arguments with the best of the advocates of the Supreme Court. The pandemic has given this opportunity to many of our lawyers to show their excellence. I have to thank everybody. There is no one who has not done a little thing for me. But there is a special thanks which I have to mention, and that is because you have to have a pillar in the family who can support you in an unstinting way, leaving you unconcerned about what is happening in your house. That is my elder brother, who has not been able to make it here. And of course, to some extent, my son, who has taken over my responsibilities. My daughter-in-laws, with their background and with their support, have been a real sense of what you call a very satisfied life, a very satisfied family life. Even though I was just now mentioning to Sister Asha that, rather quoting Ruth Ginsburg, late Justice of the Supreme Court, whose mother-in-law passed on to her, that you see the secret of a good married and happy life is that you should learn to be deaf at times. I am happy and content. My level of satisfaction is that not less that of a saint. I have not yet been able to understand the Almighty, but this legal fraternity and my entire career has taught me a lot, and I think that at the end of my mortal innings, I will be able to achieve that end. I now come to thank the entire registry of this High Court, which has been continuously working round the clock in this pandemic. And it is they who made me feel that I have the moral responsibility to remain in the High Court. Thank you very much. I would like to thank my personal staff, court staff, my drivers, and all those who have served me and fed me at the Chief Justice's residence. I would once again thank all those who have been responsible for my safe stay at Madras, including the doctors who treated me at the Rajiv Gandhi Memorial Hospital. And I must thank Mr. Kanappan, who was day in and day out over there. The registrar liaisoning had been continuously and consciously keeping track of not only my health, but the health of all judges and their families. I must thank her for her attentive role that she has played. One of my staff is outstanding, and that is Mr. Shashi, who with his most able, I would say, talent of stenography. Yesterday he taught me an English word which I used, and I shared it with a couple of judges which I had to use in an official communication. I thank him because he is an asset for the High Court. There are many other people whom I have to thank, and if I have forgotten, please excuse me. But in the end, I would ask for forgiveness if I have done anything wrong. Thank you.
Thank you, my lord. May I conclude the proceedings, ma'am? National anthem.